Welcome to the Geek Homeworld. I am your host, Savage Tech Man. We talk sci-fi, TV, movies, superheroes, and all from a geek perspective. You can find us on Blogger, Google Plus, Twitter, Facebook. We're everywhere. Join the Geek Homeworld.
Hello, everyone. This is Cheryl, and I'm taking over the podcast once again. This is guaranteed to be an ed-free episode, so get ready. Ed's just been kind of busy lately, so I told him, don't worry, I got this. So I wanted to do an episode about doctors. Our regular listeners know that I only recently got into watching Doctor Who. Why it took me so long, I don't know. And so far, I have watched, I think, nearly every episode with the 10th Doctor and the 11th Doctor. And I've just started on the 12th Doctor. I've only seen maybe 3-4 episodes with Peter Capaldi. So I'm mostly going to focus on the 10th and the 11th Doctors. As you also know, I love Star Trek, and I'm very fond of The Next Generation. We have a couple of doctors on that show who are both women, so we're going to talk about Dr. Beverly Crusher, and then also Dr. Catherine Pulaski, who is a rather controversial figure, even today. But let's start with Doctor Who. I will admit that I sometimes am a late adopter, and in the case of Doctor Who, I am a very late adopter because, of course, that show has been around since well before I was born. And even the reboot, I guess you would call it, of it, or the continuation of it recently, is in the 9th season, and I just caught on. So I want to say thank you to BBC America for having the Doctor Who takeover around the end of the year 2015, because I was able to record like a billion episodes on my DVR, and I have been trying to watch them during my spare time. Although, I don't know if they didn't air the first season or I just didn't start recording in time, so I did not get to see the 9th Doctor, but, you know, I still got what I think is among the best, but then I don't really know because I haven't seen anything else, so maybe it was better before they got to the 10th Doctor. I've seen exactly zero of the season with Christopher Eccleston as the Doctor. Some of you would also recognize him as Malekith from Thor: The Dark World. Or maybe you won't recognize him because he wore an awful lot of makeup and prosthetics in that film. He actually has a very wide film career, ranging from costume dramas to things like Gone in 60 Seconds, G.I. Joe, The Rise of Cobra, and then last year's film Legend. Before Doctor Who, Eccleston did a ton of television appearances for, gosh, 15 years or so in Britain. He's really a very well awarded actor, having received Best Actor, and he went on to win TV Choice Awards, actually for his role as Doctor Who, both as the best actor and then another award as the most popular actor. He won a sci-fi award as the best special guest star on Heroes, and just in last year he was nominated for a Satellite Award and a couple of Critics' Choice Television Awards. Nevertheless, having won awards as both best actor and popular actor for Doctor Who, he left the show after just one season as the 9th Doctor, and at the end of that season regenerates into the 10th Doctor, David Tennant, who comes in for the next season. Now, Eccleston said his experience on the show is something he looks back on with kind of mixed emotions. It wasn't something he terribly enjoyed, although he was successful in it. He himself has said he didn't like the environment and the culture of the set with the cast and the crew, although what specifically that refers to, I don't know. So at the end of his season, we get to see just briefly, I think just half a minute maybe, David Tennant. And one of the things that really excites me as the 10th Doctor is that he grew up as a true fan of Doctor Who, and actually became an actor because of his love for Doctor Who. So I just think it's awesome to get to portray your idol, and his clear love for the character in the series may also be the reason why he was able to emerge as the most beloved, most favored incarnation of the Doctor. He has continued to be recognized in poll after poll, even today, as the best doctor. And during his portrayal, he also won National Television Award as the most popular actor in 2006 and 2007. He won the Outstanding Drama Performance Award in 2008 and again in 2010. But he decided to leave the role after 3 years, saying that he thought it's better to go ahead, even though he loves the show, move on now, or he was afraid he never would. He also told BBC that he thinks it's better to go when there's a chance that people might miss you rather than hang around and outstay your welcome. And I have to say there are many actors who could benefit from that kind of advice. And we certainly do miss him, so I guess he had the right strategy. Just what is it about his portrayal that has made him such a great doctor? For me, I think it is because he is so incredibly charming and fun, but with a sincere conscience and a real sense of wanting to do what's right. And, you know, it doesn't hurt that he's young and attractive. I also like what David Tennant called his geek chic wardrobe, with a kind of crumpled up suit and the long coat and the Converse sneakers and sometimes putting on the glasses. I enjoy how excited he gets and the quizzical look on his face when he's figuring something out, and just the surprise when he comes to a realization. I wasn't particularly fond of the romantic relationship between him and his companion Rose, but I do like the fact that it was so tender and sweet, especially when they said goodbye to each other. And I have to admit that they were tearing up and I was tearing up, and it was very well done. So this doctor is emotionally vulnerable, which makes him seem really more human, although you probably wouldn't like that description particularly, although he does seem to have a fondness for humans. He needs companionship and he wants companionship, but he is afraid of it because it puts the people he cares about in dangerous situations, and sometimes he can't protect them. So over the course of his portrayal as the 10th Doctor, he has several companions. The first, of course, is Rose, who continues from the 9th Doctor. Then he's also joined by her boyfriend, Mickey, and by her mother. He also has Captain Jack Harkness. And he reunites a couple of times with his former companion from back in the old days, Sarah Jane Smith, and K-9, the robot dog. He, at one point, picks up Martha Jones, who's a medical student, and he turns her life in a totally different direction. But I think my favorite companion of the 10th Doctor is the no-holds-barred, rough-and-tumble, call-him-like-you-see-him, Donna Noble. Unlike other companions of the 10th Doctor, she clearly does not have any kind of romantic interest in him. She definitely speaks her mind. In her personal life, she really seems to lack direction. She can't keep a job, can't keep a boyfriend, all of those things. She's very frustrated. Her mother is always criticizing her. But she really does want to get things right, and she has really no fear of just charging headfirst into a situation. But she won't let anyone get in her way. She doesn't let people talk down to her. And she's not afraid to tell the doctor what she thinks either. For me, the 10th Doctor is just fine no matter what dire situations he encounters. He always has a sense of humor. And a couple of times, he is depressed, but he still is inspirational. And usually, you know, that's a reflection of his deep thinking and his deep concern for others, including the Time Lords, including his companions, including really almost anybody. He's always trying to protect everyone's life. You know, he doesn't like guns, and he doesn't like for people or aliens or whatever to be harmed, and he certainly doesn't like for anyone to be killed. As for the 11th Doctor, who's portrayed by Matt Smith, he has a lot of characteristics actually in common with the 10th Doctor. He is also young and very boisterous, and like all of the doctors, he has a distinctive wardrobe. In this case, his signature look is a bow tie, which he always insists is cool. Bow ties are cool. At some point during the show, he acquires a fez, although I don't remember them really ever explaining where the fez came from. He just sort of shows up wearing it one day. He likewise insists that fezzes are cool, but his companions really, really disagree with that. In fact, in the episode, The Time of the Doctor, he finds his fez as a museum artifact, and he grabs it immediately and he puts it on. And when his companion Clara sees it, she exclaims, "Will you ever be able to pass a fez without putting it on?" But actually, in that episode, this really distinctive hat plays an important role. It helps him to be reunited with his earlier self, the 10th Doctor, and also with a really early version of himself, a Doctor that had not been introduced before, who precedes all of the Doctors who have been in the series. And this Doctor is known as the War Doctor, and this is the Doctor who actually destroys Gallifrey, although we do discover in that episode that he actually just protected Gallifrey and he put it away for safekeeping, more or less. The Time of the Doctor is one of my very favorite episodes so far because I do really like the interaction between Matt Smith's Doctor and David Tennant's Doctor. It's fantastic, the way that they play off of each other and criticize each other. And it's also really interesting to see the two of them from the perspective of the earlier Doctor, who, although he is a much earlier Doctor by centuries, appears to be more mature, both physically, emotionally, and spiritually, and, you know, probably because he's just so distraught over the situation in his world with the war between the Time Lords and the Daleks and his decision to destroy Gallifrey in order to bring peace, I guess, to the universe. And I also appreciate it, even though I haven't seen the earlier Doctors, that at the end of that episode, all of the doctors, including the future Doctor at that point still, Peter Capaldi, shows up and they work together to resolve the situation. It's really kind of interesting to see all of the incarnations of the Doctor there together for one time. We get a more cohesive storytelling with this 11th Doctor, in that, I mean, from episode to episode, there is very much a through storyline. There's a real narrative line that kind of really focuses on his companions for the most part. When he is regenerating into the 11th Doctor, he meets a young girl named Amelia Pond, or Amy. And in that first episode, it introduces the idea that there's this gap or gash in time, and that carries through the entire length of his time as the Doctor. I do have to say, though, that the regeneration into the 11th Doctor is definitely the favorite of mine of the all of three that I have seen, because he's just so funny. I mean, he's just running around crazy and he grabs whatever clothes and he looks very raggedy, which is why Amy calls him the Raggedy Doctor. And he runs all over her house looking for food because he's starving to death. And he finally settles on what he really wants to eat, which is fish fingers and custard. For us Americans, that is fish sticks and pudding, basically. Not a delicious combo, I think, in anyone's mind, but really distinctive and definitely funny. And in fact, they come back to that again, they revisit the idea of him eating this when he transitions or when he regenerates, because when he is regenerating into the 12th Doctor, Clara comes into the TARDIS and she finds things sort of in disarray. And one of the things that she picks up is a bowl of half-eaten custard and fish fingers. So I don't know if he only eats that when he regenerates or if that's like a daily snack, but he can keep it. I definitely will not be chowing down on that anytime soon. So he picks up Amy Pond and kind of adopts her and from her childhood and is constantly coming back, and it runs through the first half of his arc as the 11th Doctor, this story about Amy Pond and also about her husband, Rory Williams, my very, very, very favorite character on the show. And if you haven't seen it, I'm going to call, just as this character would say, spoilers! I love River Song. We get River's story in pieces. In fact, we first meet River Song during the 10th Doctor, the episode with the library. And she recognizes him, and she thinks at first that he is pretending not to recognize her, but he actually does not recognize her because their timelines are interwoven, but actually she's meeting later incarnations of him early in her life and then running into earlier incarnations of him later in her own life. I don't know if I said that in a way that makes any sense, but their times cross over, but not in the same order of time. So in that episode, she meets David Tennant's Doctor, and then she comes back again later into the 11th Doctor and meets Amy and Rory. But even then, we don't know who she is. So we actually see her death before we see her birth and don't even realize who she is when she's born. And actually, the episode where she becomes the version of River Song that we have come to know and that we continue to see throughout the rest of Doctor Who. That is another really fantastic episode, Let's Kill Hitler. It's so much fun, and you really get to see the personality of River Song. But she's confused. There are a lot of things that happened in her life that have had a really negative impact on her, and calls herself even a psychopath. But she's a psychopath with a good heart, I guess, and she loves the Doctor. So the story with Amy and Rory and the Doctor and River is really very rich and very complex. The characters of Amy and Rory themselves, their relationship is really very rich too. I enjoy the ups and downs in their relationship, the kind of insecurities that Rory has, and he's completely devoted to her. He shows her great affection and great longing, and it's the kind of devotion that everyone dreams of having. We all would love to have a Rory, I think. And while they're still traveling with the Doctor, they actually run across the young woman who will become known to us as Clara Oswald, or the Impossible Girl. And it's her story that takes over the rest of the 11th Doctor's run. So after Amy and Rory stop traveling with the Doctor, he sets out to discover who Clara really is. And that's another really complex kind of story that unfolds. And she's feisty. But the truth is, she's really quite lovely. And she's very sharp. She's able to keep the Doctor in check in the way that no one else is. And in fact, one of the things that's been said is the reason that Jenna Coleman was cast as Clara was because she could actually talk faster, really out-talk Matt Smith as the Doctor. She remained with the show and with the Doctor through the next regeneration with the 12th Doctor, played by Peter Capaldi. And so both she and the 12th Doctor have a difficult time coping with his transformation. Unlike the change between the 10th and 11th Doctor, the change now is very physically different, and the personality is a lot more different than the personality between the 10th and the 11th Doctor. But they eventually both come to terms with it, and she is there to kind of serve as a moral compass for him as he tries to figure out what's going on. Although, like I said, I haven't seen very many episodes with Peter Capaldi yet. Her spunkiness and her will add a dimension to her that I think makes her more than any of the other companions, like a true partner to the Doctor. And the relationship between the characters as portrayed by Jenna Coleman and as portrayed by Matt Smith was very strong. And likewise, she was able to add a good balance for Peter Capaldi as the 12th Doctor. So she actually stayed with the series from 2012 right up to the very end of 2015. The last episode of 2015 is her, you know, not including the Christmas special in which she does not appear, but the last one, which aired in early December, was her last episode. And then the Christmas special once again focuses on River Song. And I think I've really enjoyed the 10th and the 11th Doctor, probably David Tennant more as the 10th Doctor, but the recurring presence of River Song lends quite a bit of attraction throughout the story arc of the 11th Doctor. And although I have a lot of episodes left to watch with the 12th Doctor in order to get caught up, I'm hoping that I'll come to enjoy Peter Capaldi just as much as I enjoyed the 10th and the 11th Doctor. The great news is that BBC has already ordered a 10th season, which is going to include 12 episodes and a Christmas special. Unfortunately, it is not going to begin airing until 2017. Peter Capaldi has already said that they are currently looking to cast a new companion. And rumors are rife that after this next season, the 10th season, that the producer Stephen Moffat is leaving and that he's being replaced by Chris Chibnall for an 11th season. So that's good news. We can look forward to an 11th season if that's true. But also that with Moffat, Capaldi will go in order to give Chibnall the opportunity to cast his own Doctor. A lot of people are hoping that the next Doctor will have the same kind of appeal that David Tennant had and that Matt Smith had. When you have something like this that is so long running, that you always are refreshing it. So, we shall see. Now, as for Star Trek, The Next Generation, one of the most controversial decisions was after the first season when Gates McFadden was released for different reasons. There are different stories that you hear, but the bottom line was that the head writer at the time, Maurice Hurley, wanted her gone, although Rick Berman did not agree. And because of that, he had her written off of the Enterprise. She accepts a job to go head up Starfleet Medical and make sure that she does not get killed so that he could bring her back. And that was really good foresight. So for the second season, they brought in Diana Muldaur, who actually had a heritage with the original Star Trek series back in the 60s. She had been a guest star on a couple of episodes, Return to Tomorrow, and then Is There No Truth in Beauty. She did not play the same character, Dr. Catherine Pulaski, but she did play doctors in both of those episodes, Dr. Anne Mulhall in Return to Tomorrow, and Dr. Miranda Jones, who is the assistant to the designer of the Enterprise in this very Spock-heavy episode, There Is No Truth in Beauty. There's really all kinds of madness, literally all kinds of madness in this episode. So check that out if you want to see a dynamic performance and to see her at the peak of her beauty, really, because in that episode she is very beautiful. And because, of course, by the time she came on to The Next Generation, which was filmed about 20 years, really, actually a little more than 20 years later, Diana Muldaur at that point was nearly 50 years old. And of course, especially at that time in Hollywood, women of that age were not considered particularly beautiful, maybe not even attractive. And of course, compared to Gates McFadden, who was in real life 11 years younger, or I guess still 11 years younger, they're both still alive, Diana was considered far less attractive than Beverly Crusher, and that didn't help at all. Her character was also very tough, where Dr. Crusher was much more friendly and nurturing. Dr. Crusher also served as something as a love interest for Captain Picard, but they brought in Dr. Pulaski, who was in conflict with Picard all along and also very antagonistic towards Data. And so to have her come in and be in conflict with two of the most popular characters in Star Trek history, really, across all of the shows, really did not set her up very well to be well received by the fans. And so they brought in this aging, tough lady, and she has the kind of characteristics of abruptness and directness that are not generally considered to be very appealing in women in our culture, and especially in the 1980s when this was filmed. But I believe that this characterization of Dr. Pulaski is really unfair and actually is pretty gender biased. And if you take into consideration the fact that her character was developed along the lines of Dr. Leonard McCoy, who is the doctor in the original series, they have a lot of the same things in common. They have the same kinds of personality. They have the same things they like and don't like. They don't like the technology, and they won't use the transporters, and they're both very abrupt and very direct. But Dr. McCoy, we find that endearing in him, whereas in Dr. Pulaski, we find it offensive. And so I think it's rather interesting. Also, at the time that Dr. Pulaski is introduced, we get another new character, Whoopi Goldberg's portrayal of Guinan, who becomes an incredibly popular character on the show and in later films too. Whoopi Goldberg really wanted to get onto the show and was able to do that. And probably the character of Guinan, who was a wise counselor and really an extremely old bartender for 10 Forward, where all the crew hangs out when they're not working on the Enterprise. This is really probably her most famous role after Ghost and Sister Act, of course, but this is something that people really love her for, and she provides a perspective and a sounding board for Captain Picard. And I think having her come in as a counterpoint to Pulaski, here you have the super supportive, friendly, nurturing Guinan, and at the same time you have this gruff, abrasive Dr. Pulaski. So again, just not setting Diana Muldaur up to be terribly successful. Although I don't think the character of Dr. Pulaski has been given a fair assessment by many fans, it actually worked out rather well for Diana Muldaur in the end, as part of her career. at the end of that second season in which Dr. Pulaski is on the show, Maurice Hurley left, and that enabled them to write off Dr. Pulaski. And through the efforts of both Rick Berman and Patrick Stewart, and also a lot of efforts by the fans, they were able to bring back Dr. Beverly Crusher, who was, you know, glad to come back. And she returned. This was good news for Gates McFadden because she finished out the series, and of course she appeared in the Next Generation films, although, you know, it kind of is the center of her career. It's mostly not only what she's known for, but what most of her work has been. But it was not actually bad news for Diana Muldaur. First of all, she knew from the beginning that she was only contracted for one season. She didn't know who was going to replace her, and they certainly didn't suspect at the beginning of the season that the replacement would be the return of Gates McFadden as Dr. Crusher. So that was interesting. But she went on, Diana went on to appear in the successful drama L.A. Law, interestingly, as another pushy, overbearing female character, in this case, a woman named Rosalind Shays. However, this time, people loved the fact that she was very difficult. And for Muldaur, it was very successful because she ended up earning, I think, a couple of Emmys for her portrayal. And then she also has definitely one of the most infamous endings to her character. It's been controversial. She is waiting for an elevator and talking to someone else and not paying attention. The elevator doors open and she steps in, but there is no elevator car and she falls to her death in the elevator shaft. Yeah, not a good way to go at all. And people were horrified by it. But like I said, it is very well remembered in the history of television altogether. And like I said, it's kind of perplexing how Rosalind is celebrated for her gruff personality, and the fans of L.A. Law really enjoyed watching her be a horrible person. And no one was more surprised by that than Diana, who of course had gone through this with Star Trek and how people felt about her Catherine Pulaski. Diana was very shocked because she felt that Rosalind had zero redeeming characteristics. Back on the Enterprise, Dr. Crusher goes back into this on-off-again romantic relationship with Picard. Her story arc is kind of interesting, although she actually is probably the least important and the least presented of all of the main characters, recurring characters on The Next Generation. I think it's also very interesting that she and Pulaski are the only women doctors in the entire Star Trek universe. And so on the blog, I'm going to talk a little bit about why I think that is. And then I'm also going to dig into the men doctors from the original series, Enterprise, Deep Space Nine, Voyager, and who those guys are and what they've done with their careers. So check that out on the blog, which is geekhomeworld.blogspot.com. And hope to see you guys again next week. Well, I guess I won't see you, but you know what I mean.
Thanks for listening to another episode of the Geek Homeworld podcast with your host, Savage Tech Man. You can find us on Libsyn, Google Plus, follow us on Twitter, like us on Facebook, listen to us on iTunes, see us on YouTube, be part of our Mixlr chats. Thank you. See you again on the Geek Homeworld podcast.